Hi, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Camp, and welcome to another video in our series, Advanced Development in Grasshopper. So in the previous video, I discussed how there's this special area, this is a special section on Grasshopper's C# script components called the custom additional code. And I discussed how we can add functions and classes here to extend the functionality of a component, but I also discussed how we can add variables. And that seems a little odd, because why would I want to add variables? Basically, I can have whatever data I need, I can have it coming in from the inputs, right? Well, it turns out that what's really interesting about declaring variables in this area, or in C# terms, creating members that are full members of the class that are not declared inside of a function, what I gain with that is that the data and the values that are inside of those variables all of a sudden become persistent. And by becoming persistent, what's really nice is that we break free of the paradigm that regular Grasshopper components have about data being volatile or only existing for a particular solution, for a particular execution. And this has advantages when we want to do things that are a bit more complex than regular acyclic graph computations, such as, for example, creating simulations or giving the impression that we are doing continuous execution inside of Grasshopper. Blah, 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 blah. That was a mouthful, but what does that, let's see examples of what I mean with all of this. So for example, let's say we have a C# script component and it has some kind of input, whatever. It's a dummy input. We're not even going to use it. So it's just something that is changing over time, all right? Or it changes with the scrolling of a slider. And this data could be used for this component for whatever calculation. I don't know, calculating half of the value, it doesn't really matter. But what I wanted to do is, on top of whatever calculation this does, which is, for example, going to be, yeah, calculating that A has to be equal to AX divided by 2. And actually, in order to do that, I should turn this into a number, which I absolutely forgot, all right? So A is going to be 6 divided by 2, whatever. Just some random calculation. But what's interesting for me is that I want to use this component to also calculate how many times in the life of this component has been executed. So if I'm doing this, if I'm scrolling this, how many times this value has been calculated by this component? Or in other words, again, how many times this component has executed the run script function, correct? If I wanted to do that, I might be inclined to say, well, let me define first here a variable that I'm going to call iteration, and then I'm going to initialize at 0, and then every time I run the script, I'm just going to increase it by 1 unit. And then here over executions, I'm just going to output that value. If I were to do that, let me plug in a panel here. If I were to do that right now, I get the value of 1. But as you can see, as I keep executing this component, the value of 1 is not changing. And it's not changing because if we remember the rules of variable scoping, the variables have the scope of the block of code in which they were declared. Because it, iteration, has been declared inside of this function, what is happening is that Grasshopper, every time Grasshopper executes this function, this variable gets created, it gets a value of 0, it gets increased by 1, and it gets output. But then, as soon as we hit this curly bracket, this variable expires, this variable ceases to exist, and therefore its value doesn't carry on to the next execution and the next time we execute this component. You see what the problem is, all right? But this is very simple. It's just because, again, variables only have a lifespan of the block that they are declared in. What's the solution then? Well, the only thing that I need to do is I need to declare that variable somewhere where it will not expire when I execute my function. And that somewhere, as I was saying before, turns out to be in the parent scope to the function, which happens to be the root scope for this class. So when the variable is declared here, all right, the variable, it becomes persistent. It exists throughout the life of the component. And every time the component executes the run script, it doesn't create a new variable. It just reuses whatever value it had. So for example, let me now press play. I have moved this here, and now let's check what's going on. As soon as I move the component, you can see how the count of how many iterations I have executed, it just keeps going up. Every time I give this component a new value, anytime I change any of the inputs, even if this was not being used whatsoever, okay? Even if that was not the case, even if there was no such calculation, I would still be executing this component over and over again and getting all these iterations. You may have seen that what happened, that something happened when I changed the code and I executed this, this number went back to zero. That is because changing the code actually does change the whole thing, because Grasshopper internally needs to recompile this C# script component, and therefore this gets reset to zero. Everything gets created again. But that only happens if I actually change the code. If I don't change the code, and if I just keep this here forever, then this number is going to keep increasing forever. And again, right now I'm using this input just as a way to trigger this component to execute again, even though the actual value, I'm not using it at all. And actually, in that same spirit, let's see what happens here. Let's see, I removed this because now there's no input. This gets executed again. But if you remember, there's this other component called the trigger. And the trigger is a component that is very popularly used. You can drop it, you can link it to a component. And the trigger is a component that does this effect called ticking. And ticking is, in computer programming, is something that is referred to activating or triggering something without no effect, or without really caring about the data that is triggering that event. Okay, so if I do that and I press play here, you can see how the trigger actually does tick this component and it forces it to execute again. And if I set a timer, so for example every 100 milliseconds, you can see that this component is ticking and is forcing this component to run script again. And therefore, this component keeps increasing. For example, let's say that I wanted to, now, for example, let's say that I'm going to declare here a value that is going to start at 2, okay? And then every iteration, value is going to be equal to whatever it was times 1.2, for example. And I'm going to declare another output here that is going to be B, for example, and then B is going to be equal to that value. Okay, if I do this, now you can see that B has the value of 2.4, but if I now execute this, you can see how this value is going to start increasing exponentially. Not exponentially, but it's going to start increasing until it reaches like a very large value. You see, because this data is persistent. Okay, shall we take a look at a cool example of how this can actually be helpful for doing simulations? Should we write something where we can move a point dynamically in three-dimensional space? Well, before we do that, I actually forgot that what I wanted to do is, I wanted to figure out a way, because right now this keeps increasing forever and ever, and if I did not have the capacity to actually change the code, I would not be able to reset any of these values. Is there any way that I can implement, without changing the code, a way to reset any of this? I think there is. So let's say that I'm going to include a new input called R, and which is going to be of the type Boolean. Okay? If that is the case, I'm going to press put a button here. And then I'm going to double click, and I'm going to use this flag, this input, to reset all the values. So the only thing that I'm going to need to add is if R is true, or we know that we can shortcut this, if R is true, then what we can do is we can say whatever IT was before, I don't care anymore, I'm going to force it again to become zero. And whatever the value of val was before, I also don't care, I'm going to initialize it again to the value of 2, right? So let's take a look. I'm going to use my dummy input to manually force some updates here without the trigger, okay? I can also use the trigger, that's perfectly fine, but then if I press the button, you can see that I just reset everything. And it's interesting because I press once and it gets reset, but as I release the button, that triggers another update. So now this component has been executed twice. You see how interesting that is? Because this input goes from true to false, and that's 2 executions of this input. So I could have this running infinitely, and I have now a button that I can use to reset these operations as we go. Okay. Beautiful. I think it's time now to see an example of how can we apply this to moving geometry or simulating geometry. So for example, I have created this scaffolding component, which is, I have created a point in Rhino. I have brought this point with a parameter component here. So I have the point now inside of Grasshopper. I have a unit vector in the x direction. We will change that soon. And I have a button just to reset the component. And the component has those inputs as points, as vectors, and as a Boolean. And then what I would like to do is I would like to write a simple dynamic simulation where every iteration of the calculation, this point is going to be displaced by this vector. Okay? And just to do a vector display, I'm going to display the direction of the vector, so that's this one, and this is going to be the point. So I will also want to show the point being moved by this vector in this direction. Okay, so what I'm going to do, you see how my inputs are a point P, a vector V, and the reset flag. So what I would like to do is I would like to write some code that takes this point, and every time we update the component, it moves the point along the vector direction. So the first thing that I need to do is I need to first create a persistent point, a point that I'm going to use to store all the values that are changing and that is not going to be reset every iteration. I do that by creating it here outside of the run script function in the custom additional code part. So I can say, for example, point 3D, I'm going to call this current location, like a really long name, okay? And I'm going to, because point 3D is a struct, it needs to be initialized, it cannot be null. That's one of the things, that's one of the properties of structs versus classes. So I have a card, there should be a card popping to struct versus classes somewhere in the description, whatever. And I need to initialize it to something. So point 3D, the class actually comes with a particular version, which is an unset, which is basically a point that has no valid outputs. Okay, and then what I would like to do here is that every time, or I could also, for example, I could initialize it to new point 3D 0, 0, 0. Okay, it doesn't really, well, it does matter, but we're going to see why. Okay, and then what I would like to do is every time I execute my code, what I would like to do is I would like to take the current location, and then whatever it is, I want to update that point and move it by the V vector. So that my moved point is going to be whatever current location was, okay? If I run this code, you can see that my point is actually now on, my point is right here, let me highlighted. The point is right here. And if I put a trigger and I start updating this every, for example, 200 milliseconds, you can see that the point is moving every iteration, every time we hit, is moving 1 unit in the x direction. You see that? All right. Now, the problem is that, well, there's a couple problems here. I started at 0, 0, not at the point that I wanted. So could I change that? So for example, maybe we could say Current location, I want to initialize to P. But you see the, what the problem with this is going to be? If I run this, I get an error which says that P doesn't exist in the current context. That is because P is a value that is coming into the component, and because of the rule of scoping, this variable only exists in this block. It doesn't exist here. So that's why starting the point with an unset value, so that the component doesn't work unless we do a particular thing, like you see it's a null point, unless we do that, it doesn't work. And then how can we fix that? So because we have the reset flag, what we can do is we can say, I'm going to say if reset equals equals true, then what I'm going to make sure is that I reset everything. So current location is going to be equal to the initial point. All right. And then after that, I'm going to update it. What's beautiful about this is that now this code is not running because, again, by default, the point is set to be this point that is not valid called the point unset. But as soon as I press reset, then we forcefully turn current location, we initialize it to the value of P, and then from there on, we can actually now start working with that vector and simulate it. All right? Beautiful. And I can reset, and now we basically have a moving point that we are simulating, right? We are calculating its new position every 200 milliseconds, and we are changing that position by a particular direction vector that in this case is an unit x, but it didn't have to be an unit x. What if the point, what if the vector was a vector that I was actually controlling dynamically in real time? So I'm going to take those two points, one point, another point. I'm going to create a vector between those two points. I could do this with C sharp. I'm just doing it manually for the sake of speed. And then I'm going to use this vector. I'm going to plot this vector here. This is the direction vector. And I'm going to use that vector here, okay? And and what the result of that is going to be that if I reset, you can see that the vector is moving, but I can move the vector. If I change the vector, you can see that I'm dynamically controlling with these two points the direction that my point is moving along. And the speed, because if it's a long vector, then it moves very fast. If it's a short vector, then it moves much slower. But can you see, we could probably create video games almost with this stuff, right? And actually, I would like to take some time in the next video to put this idea to practice. So if I put the point on top of itself, then now it's just, I stop the point, you see, because the vector is zero. But I would like to take some time on the next video to make a few examples of this, make a few examples of how can we create components that work with geometry dynamically and with changing states of geometry, which is a technique that is very useful, for example, for simulations. Okay, so if you like this, I think you're very much going to enjoy the next video. It's going to be a hands-on one. So hope to see you in that video. If you like what you saw, maybe like this video, subscribe to the channel, say hi, join Discord, buy me a coffee. However that looks like, I don't know. Anyway, or just say hi, that's also perfectly fine. Thank you very much and see you in the next video, hands-on examples of dynamic simulation. Bye-bye.